The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. Since the Passover of the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as the money changers seated there. He made a whip out of cords and drove them all out of the temple area with the sheep and oxen, and spilled the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And to those who sold doves, he said, "Take these out of here and stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this, the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. Therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they came to believe the scripture and the word Jesus had spoken. While he was in Jerusalem for the feast of Passover, many began to believe in his name when they saw the signs he was doing. But Jesus would not trust himself to them, because he knew them all and did not need anyone to testify about human nature. He himself understood it well. The Gospel of the Lord. This is an event that is taking place early on in the public ministry of Jesus, very shortly after his first public sign, his first public miracle, that is, at the wedding feast of Cana. And so Jesus is still sort of an open question, even to many of his followers. But here we have him at the temple, and it's in great contrast to the Jesus that we typically see. You know, we typically see a Jesus who, you know, and the artwork doesn't help. You know, we have Jesus nailed to the cross and, just looking like he's mildly inconvenienced, or we have this Jesus that is like, you know, he's just here ready to rubber stamp everything that we want to do in life. That's not the Jesus of Scripture. Jesus was like us in all things but sin. And here, this startles us because it seems sinful to us, but it's not. This is righteous anger. This is defending the rights of God, defending the rights of his Father, and driving these merchants who are money changers and who sold animals for sacrifices at the temple. Now, mind you, these people were there legally. So they weren't breaking any laws by being there. But his anger, we know just from knowledge of the period in which this happened, is because this had happened, this custom had happened for generations. And it had happened so long. See, what they did is, the money changers were people who changed the different currencies that were brought to them. Like the Jews that lived right there in Jerusalem or in Judea, the money that they carried was Roman coin, because Judea was under the Romans at the time. But no, you're not going to bring Roman, you know, pagan coins, especially with the inscription with somebody's head on it, with the head of the Caesar. That is not allowed in the temple. And so that's a desecration. So you have to change it. Then also, if any Jews were coming up for the feast in the holy city of Jerusalem, say if they were coming up from Egypt or something, then of course they would have currency from other countries, and so that had to be changed. Then the animals were the ones prescribed by the laws of Moses, and so they were sold there for people's convenience. And these were animals too. I mean, this was all very carefully done. These animals were carefully selected and pre-screened, because the animals had to be healthy. You could not sacrifice a sick animal or an animal with any sort of blemish or defect. The animals had to be carefully bred. And so, you know, what happened inevitably is that this business developed from it. And who were the ones who were making the money off of this? Not so much the merchants, but the priests who sold the permission to set up shop in the temple. It was the priests. It was people like the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the elders, the scribes, all these people. So when we see Jesus get angry in the scriptures, it's usually towards such people, the Pharisees and stuff. Now, why is that? You know, is it just that he just has a prejudice against Pharisees or Sadducees for that matter? By the way, the Pharisees and the Sadducees were two different sects of Judaism that existed in that time. The chief difference between the two was that the Pharisees believed in life after death, whereas in the resurrection of the body, whereas the Sadducees did not. But they had one thing in common now, that they both hated Jesus and they wanted him dead. Although at this point, they still have no idea who this guy is. Like I said, it's very early on in his public ministry. We see Jesus angry at the Pharisees on repeated occasions. Remember the time when Jesus calls them a brood of snakes, a brood of vipers, and he says, look, you're like whitewashed sepulchres, tombs. On the outside, you're whitewashed and clean, but on the inside, you're full of decomposing bodies. You're full of rot, of filth. Those are strong words, but that's what makes him angry. In a word, hypocrisy. That's what Jesus cannot stand, is hypocrisy. And we see this, you know, in this case, you know, the priests are supposed to make it easy for the people to come to worship. But instead, they're, you know, what should have been a service for the people to change their currency and to purchase animals for the sacrifice, you know, became this. They were charging exorbitant amounts of money for these animals, and they were cheating the people who were exchanging currency. You know, they didn't have international rates and stuff like we have today. And so the ones who were lining their pockets, so to speak, with this money were the priests, the people who represent Jesus' Father, the ones who are responsible for the sanctity of his Father's house. So hence that righteous anger and that desire for them to get out and to take all of their filthy lucre away from the house of the Father. Hypocrisy is the problem here. You know, you have these priests who are, you know, they're acting like, oh, like they're all holy and they're very much concerned for the spiritual welfare of the people of Israel. But all they care about is the money that they're making. And then I'm sure that there were exceptions, of course, but the ones there in the temple, they were making big bucks, so to speak, big shekels off of this trade. The Pharisees, again, in another event, Jesus says, woe to the Pharisees. You know, they lay heavy burdens upon the people of God, but they themselves don't lift a finger to help. You know, they put all these added prescriptions on the people that make it difficult or impossible for them to come to the temple and worship. So Jesus sees that as an enormous hypocrisy, because for Jesus, Jesus brings Judaism to its true fulfillment. I've mentioned to you before that basically the difference between the Jews and the Greeks, were the two main civilizations in that area at the time, was that the Jews were a people of the heart and the Greeks were a people of the head. And so, you know, Judaism, and as we saw in that first reading, that identifying covenant between the people and God, between the Jews and God, what we call the Ten Commandments and the other prescriptions that were given, like the Shema Yisrael, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is God, the Lord alone is God. Therefore you are to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your strength, and your neighbor as yourself." And drill this, teach this to your children. We see this in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, verse 4. These are the identifying, these are the very core of what it means to be a Jew, what it means to be a member of the chosen people. So what Jesus says to his followers, you will remember, is, says, "I have not come to abolish the law. I have come to fulfill it." And he fulfills it, paying the price in his body and his blood, which he gives us unsparingly. He gives himself completely to us as one of these prescribed sheep or doves that would be purchased for the sacrifice. He is the Lamb without blemish. He is the one who pays the price for us in its entirety. He fulfills in his body the law and the prophets. And so he is the fulfillment of that law of the heart. And so now what he is telling us through his church, through the apostles, is that it is in the heart, not so much in our head, but in our heart, that we are going to live our faith and live it truly and live it to the fullest. Problem is, again, hypocrisy. Hypocrisy always rears its head in all of us. Let's get this out of the way once and for all. We are all hypocrites, all of us. I am a hypocrite. Everyone is a hypocrite. As long as we're sinners, we are hypocrites. Even if we speak openly about our sins, we always act differently with different people. You know, and we're taught to do so. It's part of being polite. You know, if I'm in school and my teacher gives me an F, which of course I didn't deserve, then, you know, I can't give her a piece of my mind, can I? So I'm being a hypocrite. But I'm being a hypocrite in a good way, but still I'm being a hypocrite. I am not expressing what is in my heart. I'm wearing a mask. When it comes to the faith, we all do that also. We all, you know, we tend to be good about outward signs of piety, which are good, and I stress that. Things like devotions, Eucharistic adoration, praying the rosary, these things are good and they are necessary, but they're not enough. We need to look at the inside as well. The church in the last 50 or 60 years just kind of went to the opposite extreme and only looked at the inside and just acted as if all the external things were just hypocrisy and useless. You know, so you even had priests who in the 70s and 80s would call Eucharistic adoration cookie worship. Priests would call it that because they'd be, "Oh, that's useless. No, you only have to look at what's in your heart." No. Remember again what Jesus says to the Pharisees when he calls them whitewashed sepulchres. He doesn't tell them, "Oh, just make sure the inside is clean and don't worry about whitewashing the outside." No, he says that he uses the figure of a bowl, and he says the bowl has to be clean both inside and outside. There has to be a consistency, an integrity in a follower of Christ, so that the inside and the outside is the same. And tell me, any one of us here, are we completely the same inside and out? No, we're not. We're not. And that's okay. I mean, we're not monsters or anything. It's okay in the sense that it is part and parcel of what it is to be a fallen human being. Now, it's not okay in the sense that that's going to hinder us from attaining our salvation. So the only way to solve a problem is by taking that first step and recognizing that the problem exists. You know, take for example addicts or alcoholics. You know, they can go to meetings and this and that, but unless they admit that they have a problem, that they're powerless over alcohol or over drugs or over gambling or food or whatever addictions that they have, they'll never get better because they don't admit, they don't have the humility to accept that there is a problem. Oh, I can stop anytime I want. You know, famous last words. We're the same way with our own sins. We don't have to be necessarily addicted to something, but when we sin, as Jesus tells us, we're enslaved to sin. And so, you know, we don't like to look at our hearts. It's a lot easier for me to look at other people and be like, look at that loser over there, or whatever, you know, instead of looking myself in the mirror and seeing that I have shadows in my heart. I have, and yes, maybe they're justified. Maybe they have to do with injustices. Maybe they have to do with wounds that I've received. But you know what? They may also have to do with wounds that I have inflicted on others, injustices that I have perpetrated upon others. And in my pride, I just don't want to admit that. I just don't want to see that. We all have that to one degree or another. And so here we are, in smack dab in the middle of Lent. You know, Lent isn't about giving up M&Ms or whatever. I mean, that's good. That's good. But again, that's external. It's external. We need external, but we also need the internal. What is our internal disposition of Lent? Now, I don't know about you, but it often happens to me that every year when the purple seasons come around, Advent, Lent, I get distracted with a million things, you know, the administration of the parish, constant interruptions, calls, anointings, this, that, the other, and I lose sight completely, and then the next thing I know it's Christmas or Easter, and I'm like, another year I messed up my Lent or my Advent. But here we are, it's not too late, we're on the third Sunday of Lent, and so let us ask the Holy Spirit to get rid of our fear and of our pride. Remember what St. John tells us about fear. Perfect love drives out all fear. Perfect love. None of us here loves perfectly. We're working on it. But we better be working on it because that's what Jesus commands us to do. Because oftentimes we just shrug our shoulders and we say, what can I do? Oh, I was born this way. Or, my life has just been, you know, a valley of tears. And so, you know, I'm just wounded beyond repair. You know, we love to wallow in self-pity. And again, we love to feel superior to others. We do. We all play the Pharisee. And that's why the Pharisees are mentioned in the New Testament. It's not a history lesson like, once upon a time there was this guy called Jesus and there were these bad guys called the Pharisees. No. It's for us to learn that that's me, that's you, that's all of us. We're supposed to imitate him and we're supposed to not be like his enemies. You know, just keeping it very simple. So, what are we going to do about it? Okay, a proposed course of action for me, for you, for all of us, is to just when we, you know, today, not even when we get home, today, here, now, that we're at this Mass, when I call upon the Holy Spirit to consecrate that bread and wine into the body, the blood, the soul and divinity of Jesus Christ, let us ask the Holy Spirit to come into our hearts, to come into our minds and to transform us into the people that God wants us to be. We can't put this off any longer. Easter might never come, or I might not make it to Easter. Today, the third Sunday of Lent. Ho-hum, boring. No, this is life, this is now, this is here, this is beautiful. This is the only thing that is real. And this is what we have, this is what we can hold on to, the present moment, the here and the now. So let us ask the Holy Spirit to give us the courage that we may be grown-ups, that we may be able to look squarely at our defects and to bring them to Jesus, if needs be, to bring them to the confessional, but to make straight the ways of the Lord. Now is the acceptable time, and today is the perfect time, because tomorrow either may never come or we might not be there. So may we be given that courage today, the courage to love, not in the corny sense of love, but in the real love, the love that is exemplified by that ecce homo there, Jesus scourged and almost bleeding to death and then dying on the cross. A love that is divine, that has no selfishness in it, a love that seeks to give everything for the beloved, regardless of whether we think they deserve it or not. Life is too short, and we need to do this. It is our job, it is our obligation. So may we be given the grace, and may we ask for that grace now at this very Mass. God bless you all, and have a blessed and life-changing Lent.